really enjoyed presenting Dr. Osem.
Thank you very much, Professor Tamer, and thank you, Professor Alia, for inviting me to this wonderful seminar. First of all, I would like just to let you know that Alexandria is so dear to my heart. You know, I did my internship in Alexandria, I did my honeymoon in Alexandria, and I have a heart which is living in Alexandria up till now, while in Boston. Thank you for, you know, inviting a diabetologist to this topic. But, you know, the whole idea of nutrition and diabetes took significant amount of my practical life up till now. So I think it is a very important topic for discussion, especially that we have a lot of new information. But just to go back to what Hippocrates mentioned in the old days, saying that let food be the medicine and let medicine be the food. And every day we believe that this is one of the most important statements that had been said in the history. And we see every day how nutrition can modify some diseases, especially diabetes. But I would like just to say for thyroid, foods alone will not cure thyroid disease. However, a combination of the right nutrition and medication can help restore thyroid function and minimize symptoms. And that's the aim, because we frequently prescribe medication, we diagnose cases, but when it comes to nutrition, we are short of giving our patients the right advice. So I hope by the end of this presentation, you will get a glimpse of what is needed to be done for patients with the thyroid disease. So let me first tell you the objectives of my presentation. First, we'll enumerate with you the modifiable factors by nutrition and hypothyroidism. And then we will explore food that enhance metabolism. Maybe some of you don't know that certain food can enhance metabolism. That's actually true. And then we will discuss minerals that affect thyroid function. And we have at least three very important minerals that we need to be sure that our patients are sufficiently supplied with those minerals. And then we will make some hints about goitrogens. Goitrogens is very important because they are in every food that we eat, and how they will impact and how we can mitigate their drawbacks. And then finally, I will describe the ideal food for patients with hypothyroidism. So let me first start by, if you have someone with hypothyroidism, whether the cause is Hashimoto's thyroiditis or iodine deficiency or secondary hypothyroidism, there are several factors that you can modify by nutrition. As I mentioned, slow metabolism on the top of them, which leads mostly to weight gain, and iodine deficiency, and this is again a very important topic, and then hypercholesterolemia, which usually secondary to hypothyroidism, and then weight gain, which frequently you will see in those patients, although many are not, and then finally fatigue and hair loss. And you can see that those by nutrition, you can minimize all those symptoms to a great extent, and you can have a much better quality of life. So let me start by a slow metabolism. And we know that when people have hypothyroidism or even subclinical hypothyroidism, they have definitely slow metabolism and they have lower basal metabolic rate. So the only way to enhance metabolism is to increase protein intake. And protein increase what's called thermic effect of food, also called diet-induced thermogenesis. So diet-induced thermogenesis is basically the percentage of the increase in energy expenditure on the top of the basal metabolic rate. So different food categories or macronutrients have different diet-induced thermogenesis. Like for example, if you eat protein, the increase in energy expenditure will be 15 to 30%. While if you eat carbohydrates, the increase will be around 5 to 10%. And finally, if you eat fat, the increase will be around 0 to 3%. So people with hypothyroidism need to eat more protein. So just to give you an example, if someone increased protein intake to around 30%, which is up from the casual 15 to 20%, or even typically now is around 11% in some places, this will have a huge impact because this will increase energy expenditure by 891 kilojoule per day on the resting metabolic rate. So protein is very important for those patients to increase metabolism. So the second point is iodine deficiency. And not necessarily everyone with thyroid problem has iodine deficiency, but you need to be sure that they get enough iodine, because this is definitely a risk of hypothyroidism. But it's a very common scenario across the globe. So if you take the globe and you evaluate them, you will find nearly one third of the world population are iodine deficient. This is not that common in developed countries where iodinized salt is used and iodine-rich seafood is widely available. Of course, in Alexandria, you won't have any problem with this. You live by the sea. But it is very, very important to be sure that your patient get the right amount of iodine. In reality, iodine supplement is not necessarily most of the time, because natural food and especially Mediterranean food will give enough amount of iodine. Maybe you will need to be optimal in hypothyroid and pregnancy, for example, and be sure that patient receive every day around 150 microgram of iodine per day. But you have to be very careful that if you push hard and you get more iodine, then you may induce thyroid autoimmunity, thyrotoxicosis, iodine-induced goiter, and hypothyroidism. So you are between two scenarios, iodine deficiency and then normal iodine and then extra doses of iodine. So you have to be very careful in that scenario. So what food that has enough amount of iodine? You definitely the iodinized salt, which is used across the globe everywhere right now, especially in developed countries. I think in Egypt you have iodinized salt. But if you don't have it, seafood, especially all kinds of fish, and dairy products and eggs have enough amount of iodine, and especially egg yolk has a lot of iodine. So be sure that your patients will always eat enough fish and eat enough eggs and dairy, and this will be more than enough to provide the amount of iodine that your patient will need. Then the following point is hypercholesterolemia. And a lot of people think that you can modify hypercholesterolemia only by nutrition. You can definitely do improvement in triglycerides and HDL, especially if you lower carbohydrates down. But changing LDL is a problem. And most patients with higher LDL may end up needing statin or other medication to lower LDL. But there is a lot that you can do in by food, not only to treat it, but to minimize the aggravation of the situation of hypercholesterolemia. So let me give you an example. People in general, to lower LDL, they need to avoid entirely trans fat. As you know, trans fat is the worst type of fat. This is in margarine and partially hydrogenated oil. And Harvard School of Public Health showed that if you eat 1 gram every day of trans fat, risk for coronary artery disease will go up by 93%. So now in the United States, starting from early this year, there is zero trans fat in the entire country, and many countries did the same. Unfortunately, Egypt and Pakistan are still the highest countries in the globe that are still using trans fat. So trans fat raises LDL and lowers significantly HDL. So this is one of the worst fat that you should avoid. So you find it in shortening, in cakes, in many of the over-the-shelf food products and candies and so on. Then reduction of saturated fat from meat and processed meat. We found recently that saturated fat from dairy has no problem. We just finished a study, randomized clinical trial, comparing high fat dairy versus low fat dairy, and we didn't find any difference in lipid profile, or even A1C, or even body weight. And many others are showing that saturated fat in dairy is different than saturated fat in meat and its impact. So reducing saturated fat from meat, and especially processed meat, because preservatives like nitrites and nitrates also increase the risk for cardiovascular disease. Then much use of monounsaturated fat, especially olive oil, canola oil, and avocado. This is a kind of fat that lower LDL and increase HDL, so it will be very beneficial on both ways. And then you have fatty fish, especially malt fish, samak al-bouri, which is fatty fish. It has a lot of omega-3, and you can see it in deep water fish as well, and cold water fish. And if you have an EPA, which is very high, omega-3 reduce triglycerides significantly. And then polyunsaturated fat, you can see it in vegetable oils, except coconut oil and palm oil. And then you see it in nuts and seeds. Those are all beneficial. And then finally, increased soluble fiber. And soluble fiber are found in fruits. The fiber in vegetables are insoluble fiber. And insoluble fiber may help the colon, but soluble fiber will reduce cholesterol absorption significantly, around 10% maybe reduction that can get from soluble fiber. So you can advise your patient with some dietary information that can help them with the hypercholesterolemia. And then when it comes to weight gain is a problem, and especially in Egypt, it became a huge problem. And especially among women, you can see significant increase in body weight, and the percentage of people who are obese now is more than ever. So lead to a very efficient weight reduction, similar to what we do in our programs, we aim always to reduce body weight by 5 to 10%. But people need to know what exactly the dietary intervention. And I will just give you a very quick glimpse on dietary composition that can help weight loss. And then people ask about exercise, what type of exercise, what duration, and what frequency of exercise. And then there is something called cognitive behavior modification, and also change in some medication that cause weight gain. And especially people are taking some of the diabetes medication that cause weight gain. But the most important is that how you can maintain all of those and help that person to maintain weight loss for longer duration. So let me start first by dietary intervention, because changing macronutrients, even without cutting caloric intake that much, may have a good impact on weight and weight loss. So the ideal composition that we think that work for weight loss, and we've tested that for many years, we have programs that using it for almost 15 years, is to cut caloric intake just by 500, not that much. And even 250 will be fine. But the most important is to cut carbohydrates down to around 40-45% and lower glycemic index of carbohydrates. This is again very, very important. So the carbohydrates has no impact on the postprandial blood glucose level or postprandial lipid profile. And then, as I mentioned, increase protein intake to around 30%, or 1 to 1.5 gram per kilogram of body weight, if you would like to calculate or body weight, and I prefer that type of calculation. So the absolute amount of protein will be enough. Increase fiber to around 14 gram per 1,000 calories. So you will get around 30 grams of fiber per day. Then monounsaturated fat. And as I mentioned, cut saturated fat from meat and lower sodium. Mediterranean diet, which is very common in Asia, is a very, very good diet that can be used in that scenario. But I think we started to be more westernized in the diet and increase carbohydrates and processed, highly processed carbohydrates is significantly up now. So if we go back and correct all of those, I think it will be very valuable. And you can see gradual weight loss over time. And as I mentioned, protein is very important. Then exercise is very important. We know that exercise reduces visceral fat, which leads to insulin resistance and atherosclerosis as well. Blood pressure goes down, lipid profile improves, usual exercise raise HDL up, lower triglyceride. It may not have a huge impact on LDL, but you will see reduction in triglyceride and increase in HDL. And then it also improves metabolic control if someone has pre-diabetes or diabetes, increase physical fitness, quality of life. People can maintain weight loss for longer duration if they maintain good level of exercise. And finally, it improves vascular resistance and improve it and increase blood flow. And that blood flow per se will create a shear stress that produce nitric oxide on the lid blood vessels. That's why it is very beneficial. But what type of exercise should be done? People should do 10 minutes of each type of exercise on the screen, stretching for 10 minutes, aerobics for another 10 minutes, and strength exercise for 10 minutes. Those are very important because stretching reduce chance for injury, increase mobilization, increase range of movement, increase blood flow. People can do it in the morning, just 10 minutes. And then aerobic exercise could be just walking, fast walking after lunch for just 10 minutes. And in the evening in front of the television, 10 minutes of stretch exercise, which can be more than enough. Mind that 10 minutes, 10 minutes, 10 minutes, those are 30 minutes, 210 minutes per week. In people with thyroid, aerobic exercise is very important, and it pushes the basal metabolic rate in a good direction, even for longer duration. Strength exercise with protein is also very important because thus you maintain the bulk of the muscle mass during weight loss. But people in general, above age of 40, start to lose significant amount of muscle mass. And it can be as easy as using a stretch band and do most of the exercises by stretch band, which can be very simple, and people can back it when they try. So this can help significantly with the weight issue. Then I will move now to minerals that affect the thyroid gland. And I will mention two important minerals. We need to be sure that your patient is getting enough of those elements. The first one is selenium. And you should know that thyroid is the organ with the highest amount of selenium per gram of tissue in the body. Selenium is very, very important for the thyroid function. And selenium is needed, you know, this is an antioxidant needed for the antioxidant function and also enhancing the metabolism of the thyroid. Selenium supplementation of patients with autoimmune thyroiditis is usually associated with reduction in the anti-thyroid peroxidase antibody level and improved thyroid ultrasound features and improve quality of life significantly. So selenium is again very important, but don't try to do a selenium supplement I will say outside the food supplement, because you may end up with higher dose of selenium, which is not needed, especially in patients with Graves' disease. Selenium will be very important for the eye complications it will delay the progression of the eye complication significantly. And as I mentioned, in improve the quality of life. Most food has enough amount of selenium, but if you need just to be specific on what food that increase selenium, sardine and tuna is very, very good source of selenium. Eggs, as I mentioned, and eggs has significant amount of selenium. And then finally, you will find in legumes, which people in Egypt eat a lot, peas and beans, and all of those can be very good source of selenium. But as I mentioned, supplementation may provide a large dose, and selenium may be toxic in large amount. So be sure that your patient will have a good source of home nutrition. Don't give them too much supplement that contains selenium. But most of the dietary supplements right now and over the counter are not very high in selenium, but in general, just to be careful for higher doses. So those are the sources that your patient will definitely need. The other salt that is important is zinc. And as you know, zinc deficiency may decrease thyroid hormone level and also reduce resting metabolic rate. So zinc supplement have a favorable effect on the thyroid hormone levels, especially on total T3 and resting metabolic rate. So be sure that your patient will get enough amount of zinc, especially from natural food. Zinc deficiency is very rare, and especially very rare in developed countries because it is abundant in the food supply. But if you would like also to know what food that has enough amount of zinc, just think of shellfish and red meat, of course, so, lean red meat, and then chicken. Those are three good sources of zinc. I think is opened now that much. You know, I'm missing the shellfish in Alexandria. This can be fantastic. And then the fish and the lean meat. Those are very good sources of zinc. And supplements are not needed most of the time. So you can get zinc and selenium in a very good way by natural type of food. Then goitrogens. Goitrogens, these are certain types of food that, you know, if you give them, especially in the presence of iodine deficiency, you will end up with a larger thyroid to a great extent. That's why they get the name of goitrogens. So as I mentioned, they are in many food that we eat every day. But the good news is that once they are cooked, the goitrogens effect is gone. So this is very, very important. So if you have your patients cooking this types of food, then the goitrogen effect will be minimal. So the food that contains significant amount of goitrogens is soya. Soya is very, very common now as a meat substitute and source of vegetable protein across the globe. And then some vegetables like cabbage, cauliflower, spinach, and broccoli and kale, those all has a good amount of goitrogens. And among fruits, you strawberry and peaches, they have a good amount of goitrogens. And then peanuts and pine nuts, which are frequently used as well. Those are not a good idea for someone who has iodine deficiency. So the chances for enlarged thyroid will be higher. So avoid them or use them as cooked, as I mentioned. Let me end up with a question that most people ask. If I have a patient with hypothyroidism, what type of food I will give them? So to make it simple and summary, eggs, as I mentioned, eggs are very, very good. The albumin, the white albumin will give enough protein, and the yolk will give enough selenium, and also will give enough iodine, which can be a very, very good source for patients. Then lean meat, as I mentioned, that's you reduce saturated fat, and meat is a very good source, as I mentioned, and poultry for zinc. And then seafood, as I mentioned, especially fatty fish, and also salmon and tuna, shrimps, shellfish. Those are all also very very good sources. And then vegetables, and as I mentioned, we need them in moderation, and they need the vegetables to be cooked, so the goitrogens are absent. And then fruits. And as I mentioned, fruits has soluble fiber, which is very good, but fruits as well is a very nice source of fiber, and will be very helpful for those people. Gluten-free grains, especially rice and flax and chia, those are all very good. And then dairy products, as I mentioned, especially yogurt and cheese, those are all good type of food that you can supplement. And then if you need to give beverages, avoid caffeinated and give water and non-caffeinated beverages. Those are kind of diet that you can recommend for a patient with hypothyroidism, that will provide them with enough selenium, with enough zinc, with enough iodine, and enough fiber, and will help them to reduce cholesterol to a great extent, LDL cholesterol, and also maybe help them for weight loss if you increase the protein and create a thermogenesis, as I mentioned, and also cut carbohydrates significantly down, process the carbohydrates. That's why we said here gluten-free. So to end up and to take to practice message from my presentation, increased protein intake is very important in case in patients with hypothyroidism. It enhances metabolism by increasing thermogenic effect of food. Always remember to give your patient enough protein, fish, poultry, and vegetable proteins as well, and lean meat can be a very good source in that scenario. Food improved iodine deficiency includes fish, eggs, and dairy. So be sure that those are among the food that you will give to your patient, especially in patients with hypothyroid and pregnancy. Those kind of food that will be definitely needed. As I mentioned, selenium supplement is very, very important in patients with Graves' disease because it reduces the progression in eye complications and also improve the quality of life. So be sure that selenium is supplied in a good amount. Then zinc supplement, as I mentioned, has a very good effect on the thyroid hormone, especially total T3 and resting metabolic rate. And there are certain types of food that has zinc in good amount. And we mentioned shellfish and the meat and the poultry. And then goitrogens are found in many food, so you want to be able to avoid them, but inactivate them by cooking, which can be very valuable. And then finally, certain food are ideal for patients with hypothyroidism, including eggs, dairy, seafood, gluten-free grains, and certain vegetables and fruits. With this, I think we covered a lot in a short period of time, and I hope this will be valuable for everyone. With that, I would like to thank you so much for good listening.